Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So, this talk is about an agreement problem called lattice agreement. This is joint work with a bunch of other people at Microsoft Research India. A lot of this, I must add a disclaimer that a lot of this is still work in progress. So if you have feedback or comments on the slides, that will be very useful. Okay, let's get started. So here's the outline of the talk. Basically, we'll start with looking at lattice agreement first in a simple synchronous setting, and then talk about lattice agreement in a more general asynchronous system. I'll talk about this interesting problem called generalized lattice agreement, and talk about some of the applications of lattice agreement in doing things that over the last few days you've seen people talk about, things like state machine replication and view maintenance in a distributed system. Okay, so just to recap, as Rama mentioned, we've been looking at consensus over the last several days. And consensus turns out to be one instance of agreement problems. The problem, as we know, is fairly simply stated, that you have some n processes. And each process starts with some initial value vi, in this case ui. And the goal is for every process to eventually decide on a value vi, right? The properties that each vi must satisfy is that if some process decides on a value, then all processes must decide on the same value. And of course, we require that values don't appear from thin air, that the value you each process eventually decides on must be one of the input values. Right? So this is what we know. What we also looked at is that even if you assume reliable communication between processes, the FLP result, the one Marcos covered, shows that there is no deterministic algorithm for solving consensus in a very general asynchronous system. Right? We looked at Paxos, which is one algorithm that tries to solve consensus. And it's an algorithm that always ensures safety. It guarantees that if processes eventually decide values, then they will decide on the right values. But it doesn't guarantee liveness in the most general setting. More specifically, it requires that quorum of correct processes should be up at any point in time. It also requires reliable delivery, but it also requires a stronger assumption that at some point in time, the network must appear as if it's synchronous. Like eventually, it might not be synchronous at any instant in time, but eventually, the network must be synchronous, and you should be able to, for example, detect with some guarantee, detect that a node that appears to have failed has actually failed. Right. So an interesting question to ask, at least from a theoretical perspective, is that what kind of agreement problems can you actually solve in a more general asynchronous setting, where you, in fact, don't want to make this eventual synchrony assumption. One of the sort of practical reasons why you might want to do this assumption about eventual synchrony, if you don't design your system very, very carefully, can give you a lot of pain and can often lead to very subtle bugs. So you have to design, at the very least, you have to design your system carefully and somehow guarantee termination. So this is an interesting question to ask, that, you know, let's ask what can you do if you don't make this eventual synchrony assumption. So lattice agreement turns out to be one of those agreement problems. So this problem is also fairly simple to state. We are going to assume that there are some n processes. And each process is going to, again, start with a value, ui, except that we are going to impose a constraint on what values you start with. Right? So we are going to assume that the processes start with a value, and these values belong to a lattice. Right? So a lattice is basically a set with a partial order. So the partial order is represented by this less than equal to sign. And we are going to assume that all processes start with values from this partial from this lattice. More specifically, we also require that the lattice be a join lattice, in the sense that for any two elements in the lattice, there must exist a join in the lattice. Right? So that operator is the join operator. And we are going to assume that for any two elements in the lattice, the join also must exist in the lattice. Right? So we are going to assume that So it's a slightly more constrained setting than consensus in general, where values can be arbitrary values. Okay, so this is the input to the agreement problem. What we require is that eventually, just like in PaxOS, we eventually require every process to output a value vi. The conditions are that the first condition is validity, that each process, the output of each process must be a join of one or more of the input values, right? So a join is a lattice specific operator that takes two elements. It's a binary operator. So for example, if you think about a parse set lattice, and I'll give some examples later, then the join might be the union. The union. For least upper bound, for example. Right. So you have to have a join that exists. Okay, so we require that the output has to be a join of one or more of the input values, including its own. The other consistency constraint is a little more interesting here. The consistency constraint says that if you look at any two values that two processes output, those values should be comparable in the lattice. That either one must be, so they must be related using the partial order. Either one must be less than the other, or the other value must be less than the first one. So they must be comparable. Another way of thinking about this is that if you think about the lattice, then all values, the union of all values that any process learns, that all the processes learn, must form a chain in the lattice. Right? And I'll show some examples to illustrate this. And what we also require is that eventually every correct process must output a value. Right? That's a termination condition. So let's look at before I show an example, one interesting difference between this problem and consensus is that note that none of the processes, each process is going to output a value, but none of the process knows what the other values in the chain are. If you knew the other values in the chain, and if you knew your position in the chain, then in fact you could reduce this to consensus, right? Because then you could deterministically choose one of those values and emit it, and you would be solving consensus.
So just to make sure that I understand, there is no requirement that the values be again the same. We could actually decide
different values.
So in
yes.
Sense, because typically when I think about
agreement,
I think
yes.
About
yeah. So this is a weaker agreement problem. It doesn't require the processes to agree the same value. It just requires that the values form a chain. Okay, so here's an example. So the example is a simple parse set lattice. So the values here are the bottom is the empty set, and then there are singletons, values A, B, and C, and we are going to assume a finite lattice for now. And then there are sets with cardinality of 2 that are at the next level. And the join of, for example, so this represents a join of A and B. And then finally, at the top, you have A, B, and C. So this is a standard parse set lattice. And now we are going to allow processes to pick any values from these lattices, right? Initially. So for example, let's say if you have three processes, they might pick values A, B, and AC, right? And what we require as an output is that processes must learn values that form a chain. So for example, the following output is correct. So if P1 outputs A, P2 outputs AB, and P3 outputs ABC, that's a valid output. These values form a chain in the lattice. So this is a chain, and each process's output includes its own value. So this is a valid output. This is also a valid output. So let's assume process P1 crashes, it doesn't output a value, but P2 and P3 output these values. That's also a valid output, right? But this output, the following output, is not a valid output. So if P1 outputs AB, P3 outputs AC. That's not valid because these two values are not comparable. One is not strictly less than the other. So as you can see, this is a weaker consensus problem, which is what you would expect, right, from a problem that can actually be solved. So let's first look at a synchronous algorithm for solving lattice agreement, and this was work by Attia, Hurley, and Rachman. In fact, this was studied originally in the context of an asynchronous shared memory system, but the synchronous algorithm is actually a message passing algorithm. So we'll see how this algorithm works. Okay, so the algorithm is going to use a recursive branch and bound strategy. So what we are going to do is the algorithm is going to proceed in rounds, as we do in a synchronous setting. And initially, when we start, we are going to so we have a set of processes, and without loss of generality, let's assume that the number of processes is a power of 2, right? And what we are going to do is that we are going to split the processes at every level into 2 halves, and we are going to pre-designate processes in every round to be split into 2 halves. So at the first level, we are going to have 2 halves of processes. One half is called the ordinate set of processes, and the other half is subordinate. And we are going to assume that processes know whether at each level what half they belong to. Right? So at the first level, when in the first round, all subordinate processes, at least the ones that are correct and not faulty, are going to send their values across to all ordinate processes. Right? And the ordinate processes are now going to compute a join of all the values they receive at the end of the round and use that in subsequent rounds. Right? And at every level, we are now going to split each group into 2 more halves. Right? So you can see how this goes recursive branch and bound. At every level, we are going to split any group into two sub-halves. One half is ordinate, the other half is subordinate. And the subordinated processes are going to send all their values to their current values to the ordinate processes. So let's see how this works. And basically, at the last level, which is that what happens at the log n plus 1 level, each process just is independent on its own. And that process is just going to output its current value. Right? So let's see how this works. So let's assume that there are 8 processes. In the first round, which is level 1, we are going to split the processes in such a way that P1 through P4 are subordinate, and they know they are subordinate at that level. And P5 through P8 are ordinate processes. And in the first round, all the subordinate processes send their values to the ordinate processes. Note that some of them might crash, and some of these values might not get across. That's OK. But they send their values to the second set of processes. At the next level, and the ordinate processes now compute a join of all the values they receive, including their own. The subordinate processes just stick to the value they have. They don't do anything. They just send this value across. Right? At the next level, we are going to do the same thing. We are going to split the set of subordinate processes into 2 and the ordinate processes into 2. And this process repeats for log n plus 1 rounds. So at the end of the second round, they are again going to compute a join of the values they receive. And the subordinate processes don't do anything. And finally, in this case, there are 3 levels. At the end of level 3, they compute joins, and they just output that value at the end. So is it intuitively clear why this would work? So essentially, why this works, and we'll look through a proof a little briefly. But intuitively, what this process guarantees is that the values of the ordinate processes at any level are greater than the values of the subordinate processes. And if you guarantee that at all leaves, then you guarantee that they form a chain, right? And processes can fail, which makes it a slightly tricky thing to understand, but that's the intuition. So let's try and prove this correct. So we can prove this correct by induction on the number of processes. So the base case is that you just have an instance of this synchronous lattice agreement that has just one process. And of course, in that base case, all the 3 conditions, validity, consistency, and termination are satisfied. Right? The process is going to output a value if it doesn't fail. And the value it outputs is going to include its own value. And the only value it outputs is going to form a chain, trivially. And what we are going to assume as the induction hypothesis is that you have 2 instances of this lattice agreement, the n by 2 instances, and both these instances are correct. So they satisfy all the 3 properties, and we'll try and show that the whole system satisfies these properties. So essentially, you can think of this big box, which is the instance of a lattice agreement problem for n processes, and there are 2 smaller boxes here that solve lattice agreement for n by 2 processes. and we are going to assume these two boxes are correct, and then we try and show that with this extra message passing that happens at the top, that's the whole algorithm. We'll try and show that the whole box is in fact correct, satisfies all the three properties. Okay, so let's try and show validity. So if you look at any process, one can establish an invariant that the input that you give to the n by 2 instances problems is always larger than the input you gave these processes started out with, right? Because at the very least, you are passing the same values that you started out with to the n by 2 instance. But in the case of ordinate processes, you are computing a join of some other values and giving that as input to the n by 2 instance, right? So the values that you start with in the n by 2 instances are definitely greater than or equal to than the values you started out with. They are higher in the lattice. Okay, so that is easy to see. Because we assume that the n by 2 lattice instances are correct, we are guaranteed that no matter what input you give to an n by 2 instance, the output it's going to produce is going to be larger than is going to be a join of one of the input some of the input values. So if you just use this use both these claims, then you can show that the output of the n by 2 instance for any process is going to be greater than its own input. So that's fairly simple. The same holds for the join as well. So the input of an n by 2 instance is the join of some inputs of the n instance. And the induction hypothesis tells us that both the halves are correct. So the output that the n by 2 instance produce are a join of some inputs of the n by 2 instance. So by implication, you can show that the output of the n instance is also a join of some of the inputs. So validity is straightforward to see that you are always going to compute joins, and you are always going to include your own value. Okay, so let's try and show the harder problem, which is that all the values form a chain in the lattice, right? So by induction hypothesis, we know that if the n by 2 instances, if you give them some inputs, the outputs they produce are going to form a chain in the lattice. Right? So that we know by induction hypothesis. What we are going to try and show now is this intuition I mentioned earlier, that all the outputs that the ordinate processes produce are larger than the outputs of the subordinate processes, even in spite of failures. Right? And that implies that any two outputs are going to be comparable. Right? So let's try and show this lemma that the outputs of the subordinate processes are always less than the outputs of the ordinate processes. So what we know from the layout is that all subordinate processes at level 1, they of course start with the same inputs, both in the n by 2 instance and the n instance, right? They don't change their inputs at all. And due to the validity constraint, we know that the outputs of the subordinate processes are joints of the values of the inputs they receive, right? So this holds from validity, which we just proved. Now, what the subordinate processes do, so essentially what we can show from this is that the outputs of the subordinate processes are less than equal to the join of all inputs put together, right? At the largest value a subordinate process can produce is the join of all its inputs. It might produce less, but it will at least, the largest value it can produce is a join. And if some of the processes fail, of course, that value may or may not be included. Okay, so this we know, that the output of all subordinate processes is going to be less than or equal to the join of all non-faulty subordinate processes. And what we also know is that so the all you require is that if you have two elements, if you have a set, there is a partial order defined. So the less than equal to is a partial order. It just says which elements are less than, greater than the other.
So if we have x is divided by y, then we'll get an inverted lattice of x divides y, right?
Sure.
So in that case, what do we mean by that the set of ordinate will be greater than set of subordinates, because the output of ordinate will be decreasing if it is being divided by. Suppose we have it.
This less than is in less than in the lattice, right? Okay.
And as we move upwards, it would be a kind of a diverging element. And if we take a sentinel element to make a top, then how can we say that
it's not less than in the numerical sense? It's less than in the lattice in the sense it's higher in the lattice.
So in this case, how will we define the less than element for x is divided by y?
That is the definition. That if x divides by y, then x is less than y. Or in this case, you want to define it in the inverted, right? Yeah, so you can define that way also. So if x divides, x is divided by y, then x is lower in the lattice than y. You can define it like that. Although the value is greater, but in the lattice, it's lower in the lattice. Non-faulty at the point at the beginning of lattice, at the beginning of the n by 2 instance. That's right. Yes. They may fail subsequently. That's right. So, what we also know from the way we describe the set up the algorithm is that all the non-faulty subordinated processes are going to receive a join, are going to compute a join of the values of all subordinate processes that were alive at the beginning of the n by 2 instance, right? Which means that all the inputs to the subordinate processes in the n by 2 instance is going to be greater than or equal to in the lattice, higher in the lattice than the join of all inputs of the non-faulty subordinate processes, because they are computing the join, including their own value. So they have to be at least the join. They can be higher in the lattice because they include their own value. And what we then know is that the output of the subordinate processes due to validity condition has to be the join of some of the inputs to the ordinate processes, right? So this essentially lets you show that all the outputs of the ordinate processes are greater than or equal to the outputs of the subordinate processes at the end of the n by 2 instances, right? And once you can use this to show that all the values that the n by 2 instances output are comparable in this lattice. Does that make sense? Okay, so let's look at some of the characteristics of this algorithm. So the algorithm is interesting because in a synchronous setting, it can in fact tolerate arbitrary crash failures. There is no real bound. Any process can fail at any point in time. And the complexity is also interesting. So each round is going to, each level in this tree is going to take one round. So you are guaranteed that the algorithm will terminate in log n plus 1 rounds. And this complexity is independent of the number of failures, right? So this is what characterizes what we call weight-free algorithms, right? The idea is that each process, as long as it's alive, is guaranteed to complete its computation in a bounded number of steps, no matter what happens to the other processes in the system, right? So this algorithm is in fact weight-free, because if a process is alive, no matter what happens to the other processes, each process is going to finish its computation in a bounded amount of time, bounded number of steps. In this case, it's log n plus 1 rounds. So if a process outputs a value after log n plus 1 rounds, you know that the algorithm is terminated, and all the values that are at the end, they form a chain. Right? So this is weight free. Okay. So let's now try and look at the asynchronous version of this algorithm. And there is, in fact, a direct translation of this algorithm into an asynchronous implementation. So the trick here is that if you noted, we assumed that somehow the processes knew which partitions they were in, which halves they were in at the beginning of each round, right? And that is non-trivial to do if you are in a completely asynchronous setting. So the original work, in fact, describes the translation of this algorithm into an asynchronous system where you can dynamically split the processes into halves at each level. But we are not going to discuss that instance. In fact, we are going to describe a slightly different instance of this problem, a slightly different solution to this problem in an asynchronous setting. And So what we are going to assume now is that we have n processes, and processes can crash. You can have arbitrary message delays, message loss, duplicate messages. And for liveness, the only thing we are going to require from this solution is that a quorum of processes must exist, and you must have reliable communication between processes. So that's the only thing we are going to require. Right? So note that there is no eventual synchrony assumption here. Okay. Eventual synchrony.
Oh, there was eventual synchrony, but you also...
Oh, reliable delivery.
Reliable delivery.
Yes.
Exactly the same assumptions?
Same assumptions, yes.
Just the wording is different.
Oh, I see. Yeah, it's the same assumption that a process should be able to... Yeah, sorry. So this, all you require is that if that any correct process, if it sends a message, should be received by all
so
correct processes.
So basically, the only difference is that you don't require eventual synchrony.
Exactly. Okay, so the algorithm for lattice agreement itself is actually fairly simple. It's based on very simple majority quorums, and this is something we've seen before. And the idea here is that if you have some n processes, if you look at any two quorums, any two simple majority quorums, then they have a non-empty intersection. Right? So you can basically use quorums to store a value and then make sure that it's retrieved later, even though some minority of the processes can fail. So this is a very simple idea. So let's see how we can use this. So the algorithm requires that each process play two roles. So you can have a process can play the role of a proposer. And a proposer is someone who proposes values. And the second role you play is the role of an acceptor. And an acceptor is a role that helps proposers decide or output values. Right? So proposers are going to propose values. They will start with an initial with their initial values, which is the value ui, and they will eventually output a value vi. The acceptors are going to accept or reject these proposals, and each acceptor is now going to maintain the largest value it has received as a proposal at any point in time, right? And it's going to use this value to either accept or reject proposals. It's the largest value it has seen, which includes, it's basically the join of all the values it has ever been proposed, including the one it rejects. Actually, that part is not critical to the algorithm. It's only relevant to complexity. You can, as we'll see, you can use each acceptor can only maintain the join of all the values it accepts. It doesn't have to maintain the values it rejects, but that gives you, in fact, some performance benefits. Okay, so how does the algorithm work? So a proposer at any given point in time can initiate a proposal. And what does that mean? You essentially send a propose message. And for those who know Paxos, this is a little bit like Paxos, except there are some key differences. So you send a propose message, and each propose message has a proposal ID. Right? And this ID just has to be a unique ID for a proposal. It doesn't have to be totally ordered or chosen from or comparable, whatever. It just has to be, this is just a unique proposal ID that the client, that a replica, that a process in this case can locally generate, that is locally unique, right? So it has to be globally unique, but it doesn't have to be comparable to anything else. So think of this as just like a counter that each process maintains along with its IP address or something, right? It's just an ID that identifies that proposal. And it's going to send this proposal and the value, its current value, which is initially the initial value, but over time it changes. And it will send this value to all the acceptors, and it will wait for a responses from a quorum of acceptors. Right? And what the acceptors are going to do is that each acceptor has this value ai, which is the join of all the values it has ever seen from any proposer in the past. If it sees that the value ai is less than the value it's receiving in the proposal, a vj, which is less than the value it's receiving, then it moves up in the lattice, and it sends an acknowledgement with that proposal number back to the proposal. Right? But if it sees that the value are not comparable, so either it's less than in the lattice, the value it's receiving is less than in the lattice, or it's not comparable, then it's going to compute a join of its value, so it's still moving up in the lattice, but it's now going to send negative acknowledgement or a rejection to the proposer along with its current value. Right? So what this guarantees is that,
when you say its current value, you mean the value after the join?
Yes, the value after the join. Now what this guarantees is that an acceptor's value always increases in the lattice, right? A single acceptor's value always goes up in the lattice. Whenever it receives a proposal, it always moves up. Right.
If the values are unrelated,
yes. This is an optimization. You can ignore this step. You can decide not to do this, and the algorithm still works. It's just this gives you a performance benefit. Okay. So when a proposer receives a quorum of responses from, in this case, a majority quorum, if all the responses that it is received are acknowledgments for that process ID, then it, oh, sorry, so there's a mistake here. So when, if it receives all acknowledgments, then it can basically output that value. So this is a typo. So what a process can do is that when it receives an acknowledgments of responses, it just outputs that value for the value for that proposal, right? Then it's done, basically. However, if it receives some negative acknowledgments from any of the processes, then what it does is it refines its proposal. And it refines its proposal by moving up in the lattice. And the way it does that is that it computes the join of all the values that it has received in negative acknowledgments and proposes that value in the next round. And it does that by, say, getting a new process ID and proposing that in the next instance, right? Does that make sense? Any question? So if you receive negative acknowledgments, then you move up in the lattice by computing a join of all the values, negative acknowledgments you receive, and try and propose again. This doesn't guarantee that proposal, this refinement proposal, will succeed, but it just guarantees that you are moving in a lattice. You are moving up in the lattice and proposing again. Yeah. Before?
In the beginning of round one, it has an initial value.
Yes.
So is the VI same in all the subsequent rounds?
So this becomes its new VI. Right? So once you compute this join, this becomes your new proposal value. It stays at the same place, but you never go down in the lattice.
But then why do you need to take this join with VI? Because each AJ has VI in it.
Sure. So this is just, each acceptor already has VI in it. That's right. So you don't strictly have to do this. This is enough. But this becomes your new value. You don't have to wait for all the negative acknowledgments. That's a good question. You only have to wait till you receive a quorum of responses. You can wait longer if you want, but you can decide at the point you receive a quorum of responses, you can decide to do this.
And why not reset the same value? Because at all acceptors, you already made a join of those values.
Yes. That's not required, right? So some other process can propose its value and move the acceptors higher in the lattice. So when you send, you might still get a negative acknowledgement back.
No, but then still there will be a
relationship,
right? But you are rejecting if it is unrelated or lower.
Or lower. Right? So if you go back, if the value that you receive in a proposal is lower or, so the value has to be strictly higher or equal to for you to accept. It cannot be comparable or it cannot be incomparable or lower. Right? So you have to move up and propose.
Can there be two proposals in the same round?
From the same proposer?
Two different proposers.
Yeah. So this doesn't say how many proposers can propose. Any number of proposers can propose at the same time. That's right. So what will happen is that if there are two conflicting proposals, if one of the proposers gets through to a quorum, then the other proposer now will propose and get rejected if the values started out to be incomparable. And then this proposer has to move up in the lattice by including that proposer's value. That's right. So in this case, we are just assuming a majority quorum, right? So we assume that if you have n processes, then you must wait for at least n plus 1 by 2 messages. Sorry? Yeah, yeah. So we'll get to the complexity. That's right. So yeah, I'll get to the complexity next. So let's, what we'll try and do is to first show that it's correct, that the values it outputs are correct, and then we can talk about complexity. Okay, so here's basically a state machine representation of what a proposer does, right? So initially, the proposer will start in this initial state, and then it proposes at some point and goes into a state where it has proposed a value. The proposals might receive a quorum of acknowledgments, in which case it just outputs that value. But if it receives some negative acknowledgments or rejections, then it's going to refine the proposal, go back to a proposed state, right? And it does this repeatedly till you output some value. And what acceptors do is, again, very simple. They start in an initial state where they have at the bottom of the lattice. When they receive a proposal or they receive a refined proposal, they are going to check it and either accept if the proposal is strictly larger or equal to, or reject it and then go back to this initial state. So that's the role an acceptor plays. So let's see an example. So let's say you have three processes and three acceptors in this case. So we are going to assume that the quorum, a majority quorum, is basically just two processes. So let's say they start with the values A, B, C. The process P2 is going to propose the value B, which might get accepted, right? Because initially, all these values are strictly larger. Now, if process 3 proposes A, C, then at least one of the processes is going to reject this proposal because it's already moved to B, right? So one of the processes is going to reject this, in which case, proposer 3 now has to go higher in the lattice to ABC. Now, if process 1 proposes, then it might also get rejections, right? So it will get a rejection from these two processes because they have already moved to higher values in the lattice. So this is already moved to ABC and this is moved to B, which is not comparable to the value you are proposing, which is the value A, right? But subsequently, once you move up in the lattice, well, there is only so much of the lattice to go up, right? You can only walk so much. Eventually, you are going to have to propose some value which all the acceptors are, at least a quorum of acceptors are going to accept, right? That's the intuition, that everyone keeps moving up in the lattice. And since this lattice has a finite height, that's something we assumed early on, you are eventually going, you can only make so many steps until you reach the top of the lattice, right? And at that point, a quorum of acceptors has to accept your proposal. Okay, so let's try and reason about safety. So basically, you can use very simple induction on the length of the execution to show that any output value you propose, any process, if it outputs a value, then the value is going to be a join of some proposed values, sum of the initial values. Okay. To show that any two output values are comparable, again, the reasoning is very, very simple. If there are any two output values, Vi and Vj, then, and if they have been output by two processes, then those processes must have received a quorum of acknowledgments, right? Which means that if you look at the quorum of V, you must have a quorum of Vi, which is a set of acceptors that have accepted Vi, and a quorum for Vj. And by property of majority quorums, we know that these quorums have to have an intersection. Now, if you look at any acceptor in that intersection, it must have acknowledged both Vi and Vj. But like we discussed, an acceptor always moves up in the lattice, right? It always goes one step or the other. So all the values that it acknowledges or accepts must be comparable, right? So which means that any two values that any two process outputs, they must be comparable in the lattice. Okay, so what's interesting is the liveness or termination guarantees. So it turns out that there are many ways of measuring complexity in an asynchronous system. The measure we are going to use is basically a measure of communication complexity. So what we are going to assume is that we are going to assume as if the system is synchronous. Just from the point of view of measuring complexity, we'll assume that each message takes a unit time. So we actually ignore the amount of time it takes. And then we are going to measure the number of message delays or round trips the algorithm is taking before it terminates. Right? So if you go by this measure, then what you can show is that each proposer has to output a value in order n rounds, where n is the height of the lattice. Right? So it can start with any initial value in the lattice, but in the worst case, it has to propose, its proposal is going to be accepted in order n rounds, where n is the height of the lattice, because it can only go so far. Right? So assuming the lattice is finite, order n is the worst case message delay. You did. You have to have an assumption about whether the lattice was finite.
Yeah.
In the synchronous assumption, in the synchronous algorithm, we just required a join. That's right. So in this case, I think we have an extra assumption.
Actually, in this setting, you don't need the lattice to be finite.
But you. Okay, so again, this is the intuition that every time a proposer proposes, it has to move higher in the lattice, and there is only a finite number of steps you can take. Okay, so essentially, what this shows is that asynchronous lattice agreement is also weight-free, right? That every process is going to complete in a bounded number of steps. Okay, so next, what's the time? Should we break now or? Okay, so let me just start by at least introducing this problem of generalized lattice agreement. So the idea of generalized lattice agreement is that we are going to generalize the lattice agreement problem in two ways. We are going to assume that the lattice is infinite, really infinite, and that each process, instead of starting out with just one value, in fact starts with a sequence of values. In fact, it doesn't even know the sequence upfront, right? It's going to receive values from the outside world, and the values belong to a lattice, but it's going to receive an arbitrary number of values. So it doesn't just have just one value. In fact, each process is going to receive values from the outside world. These values still belong to this infinite lattice. And our goal now is for every process to now output a sequence of values, not just one value, right? So we are generalizing this. And what we require is that we still require validity, that any value you output has to be a join of some values you've received, right? The system has received. So that we still require. However, what we also require is that any two output values across processes, both within and across processes, have to be comparable. So if two processes output two values, those any two values have to be comparable. And the termination guarantee is also a little tricky, because we can't now expect, so a process is going to output a large sequence of values, right? A potentially infinite sequence of values. So we can't expect every process to output a value and then terminate. That's not the termination condition. In fact, what we require is that every value that is received by the system, by any of the processes, should eventually be included in an output value. So there must exist an output value which is larger in the lattice than a received value. So for every received value, there must be an output, which includes this received value. So basically, this says that you shouldn't be missing any values in the lattice, any values that you receive. Yeah. doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be. Yes. So you can have, for multiple received values, the same output value can satisfy this constraint. So for every input, there doesn't have to be an output. What you require is that every input value, there, for every input value, received value, there must be an output that includes it eventually, and the output of some process.
There can be output values that does not include it.
There can be output values that don't include it, of course, but eventually there must be an output value that includes it. So you're thinking about a solution. So in a real world, the way you think about it is that each process is now going to receive values from a client, from clients, right? They are going to send values to this process, to this set of processes, and what each process is going to output is a sequence of values. And if a client sees a value in the sequence from some process, and it sees a second value from some other process, it knows that these two values are comparable. And we'll see why this is useful in things like replicated state machines a little bit later.
What I mean is that in the earlier case, when you are taking joins, so the proposer sends some values and acceptor receives it.
Yes.
But it's still serializing in some manner. Like, for example, you take join of one proposer, and you are done with that. Then comes the value from another proposer, and you might reject it or move up in the...
Exactly.
Exactly.
So the way you think about this, if you want to think about it as an extension of the previous, of the bounded lattice agreement, is that once a proposer gets its proposal accepted, it can propose new values. It doesn't have to stop there. Right? It can propose an arbitrary number of values, as long as they are in the lattice. Yeah, that's another way of thinking about it. Okay, so maybe this is a good time to take a short break and then come back. Okay, so just a clarification. There were some concerns about the complexity of the asynchronous algorithm, and I must apologize. We have to be a little bit more precise. The guarantee here is that the proposer will output a value n in order n rounds, where n is essentially the minimum of the height of the lattice and the number of proposers. It's either one of them. If the height is less than the number of proposers, then obviously you are going to converge quickly. But if the height is of the lattice is greater than the number of proposers, then still it is bounded by the number of proposers. Okay, so quick recap of the generalized lattice agreement problem. So this is a generalization that generalizes lattice agreement to sequences of values, where processes receive values from the lattice, and they don't know these values upfront. They can receive them online as the algorithm makes progress. And the values can potentially belong to an infinite lattice. And the key goal here is to ensure that any two values processes output are comparable, and that every value received is eventually included in the output. Okay, so termination. How are we going to ensure this? Yeah, let's see. Exactly, that's the point of the next few slides. Okay, so a naive solution you might think about is, in fact, to just run many instances of the asynchronous lattice agreement at the same time, right? Many rounds of this lattice agreement. So essentially, what you do is, when a process receives a value, it proposes it. And every time it receives a value, it can either propose it right away, or it can include it in the next proposal, next refinement it's going to make. Right? So that's a natural extension of the algorithm. However, a point worth noting is that since the lattice is no longer finite, this simple extension does not, in fact, guarantee termination. Right? And let's see an example why. So let's say you have just two processes and three acceptors, and they start with empty with the bottom in the lattice, and process P1 now receives a value A, from receives a value from the lattice, which is this value A, and it proposes this value right away, and then it receives a quorum of responses and outputs the value A when it receives, right? So you are going to output the value A. Now let's assume that process 2 receives a value B, and it also proposes the value B. Now of course it's going to get at least one rejection because value A has already been accepted. But then once it receives a quorum of responses, it moves up in the lattice. So it moves to a value A comma B, right? Now before it gets a chance to refine its proposal and send it to the acceptors, process A receives a new value C, right? And this is a little bit like Paxos. So process A receives a value C and it proposes a value and gets to the acceptors, at least a quorum of acceptors, gets them to move up in the lattice. Its own proposal is not going to get accepted, but what it also is making sure is that if process B proposes next, its value is not going to get proposed, right? If it proposed AB, that's not going to get accepted. What process 2 can do is that if it receives a value in the meanwhile, it can propose that value as well, and it can make them go up in the lattice in such a way that process 1's subsequent proposal are also not going to get accepted. So basically you have these conflicting proposals, and if you allow processes to propose unconstrained, they can basically make sure that the other processes don't make progress, and the other process can do the same to you, right? So if you use this naive strategy of just including proposals whenever you get them eagerly, it's not guaranteed that you make progress anymore, right? So you have to be a little bit more careful. So how do we do this? So the basic intuition is to control somehow the way processes make proposals. So essentially what we are going to do is that we are going to allow proposers to refine their proposals, so they can look at the rejections that acceptors have sent them and go up in the lattice. But if they are in the process of making proposals, so if they are trying to get an initial value accepted by refining, in that duration they cannot introduce new values that they have received, right? So if a proposer is in the process of making proposals and refining it, in that duration if it receives new proposals, new values from the outside world, it cannot include them in a proposal. It has to wait till it includes these new values, right? And this guarantees that this in fact guarantees, not only does it guarantee that some proposers' proposals will get accepted, this also guarantees, as we'll see, that every received value is eventually included in a proposal. So this is a little subtle, but hopefully when I describe the algorithm, we'll see this. But the intuition is that you want to control when a proposer can include new values in its proposals. So here's how the algorithm is going to work. So all the proposers are now going to maintain this buffer. So this buffer is also a value from the lattice. When a proposer receives a value, it can in fact receive values from clients, and in fact in this case we'll also allow it to receive values from other processes. So the first thing a proposer does when it receives a value is that it will add it to its buffer. It won't propose it right away, it will add it to its buffer. If the value is received from the external world, then it will actually send this value to all the other proposers. If it's received internally, then it will just buffer it. But if the value is received from clients, then it will send it to the other proposers. Okay. Now, once in a while, a proposer can initiate a proposal. If it hasn't initiated a proposal yet, it can initiate a new proposal, which means it will set its current proposed value to the value of its buffer, and then propose that value VI with a new proposal number. And it will propose this to all acceptors, follow the same protocol. It will wait for a quorum of acceptors to respond. Now, when a proposer receives a quorum of responses, if it receives all acts, then it's going to output that value VI. Once it receives all acts, it can then go on to propose its current buffer value. So in the meanwhile, if it has received new values, it will accumulate them in the buffer. And only when it receives all acknowledgments can it propose that value, right? In the meanwhile, if you receive NAX, then you just keep going up in the lattice. You use the same protocol to go keep going up in the lattice. But when you refine, you cannot include your buffered values in the proposal. Right? So what this is essentially trying to do is that it's although each proposer is receiving these values, at any given point in time, you are sort of constraining the proposers to a single instance of lattice agreement by sort of imposing this constraint, which makes the lattice bounded in some sense. Right? So let's see how this. So this is a proposer state machine, which is a little different from the earlier one. So you start in an initial state. If you can then propose. Once you go into a propose state, you have to, if you receive a quorum of acknowledgments, then you can go back and make a proposal again. But in the meanwhile, if you receive a NAC, then the proposal gets rejected, then you have to refine it, but you cannot re-propose from a new value again. And in this initial state, if you receive values, then you can just keep buffering them. Right? And even here, if you receive values, you keep buffering them, but you can't propose those values. And the acceptors don't change. They still do whatever they were doing earlier. Very good question. So why are we sending this value initially when we receive it? Why are we sending it to all the other proposals? So that is required to guarantee that every value received by a correct process is eventually included in some proposal.
But anyway, would be because we are accumulating in our own buffer, and that buffer will be eventually included.
But you might fail, right? So actually, failure is not so much of a problem. What this, if you look carefully, what this protocol does not guarantee is that any single proposer is never guaranteed to receive all acknowledgments. A single proposer is never guaranteed to receive all acknowledgments. All this protocol guarantees that some proposer in the system is guaranteed to complete eventually, right? And what you do by sending this proposal to all proposers is that you will enable, in some sense, you are helping other proposers help you. So values you receive, you send it to them. And by reliable delivery, we are guaranteed that if a value is received by if a correct process sends a value, it is eventually going to be delivered to all other correct processes. And if some correct process eventually is able to succeed in its proposal, then it's going to include your values. And that's how you guarantee that eventually all received values are included in some output. Yes. They will conflict. Yeah, but what the algorithm guarantees is because you are controlling at what points you can include new values, the algorithm guarantees that at least one proposer will eventually succeed in getting its proposal accepted. Right? Because since you are not allowing proposers to include new values, right, eventually the lattice is bounded.
Other proposers do include their new buffer.
But they can only include it after their proposal gets succeeds.
Okay, so the ultimate case can be all the other proposers are waiting and the last proposal gets accepted.
And then that will include all its values. That's right. Okay, so let's see how this works in that example we saw. So proposer 1 is now going to propose this value A, which it receives, and it can get this value accepted by a quorum and output it. When process 2 receives this value, of course, this value is going to get at least some rejections, in which case it moves up in the lattice. At this time, if process A receives a value, now, of course, it has gotten a previous proposal accepted. So it can include this new value. So it's going to accept this new value, and it's going to propose this new value. So it's going to propose A comma C, which is the join of the previous accepted value and this value. And this time, however, its proposal is going to get rejected. Right? So now you have two processes whose proposals are getting rejected. But now if process 2 receives a new value in the meanwhile, so it receives D, at this point it cannot propose this value because it has a proposal that is still in flight. Right? So it cannot propose this. What it can propose, however, is the value it has learned after receiving negative acknowledgments. it can propose that value. So it proposes this value AB, which unfortunately at this time will get rejected, right? However, note that it hasn't included a value D yet. So it hasn't increased the lattice further than whatever it was already, right? Now, both these acceptors move to values ABC, okay? And at this time, so it has this D in its buffer. So it hasn't yet proposed this. At this point in time, both proposers are at ABC. So either of them can propose and get their proposals accepted. So at least one proposal is going to get accepted. Now, at this point, in fact, both processes can now include D. Because if you remember, D was, when it was received, it was sent to P1 and P2. So if P2 was, in this case, P2 made progress. So it can, in fact, propose D at this point. But if P2 did not make progress, and P1 was the one that, in fact, got its proposal accepted, then eventually, it proposes the value D. But you could have another scenario where P1 got its proposal through, and it eventually received this value D from proposer P2. And at that point in time, it can propose this value and get the value accepted. Right? So hopefully, this gives you an intuition of why we can guarantee that every received value is eventually going to be included in some output. Okay, so I'll very briefly go through the proof. So what we want to prove from the safety point of view is that every output value is a join of some input values, and that is fairly easy to see. What we also want to show that any two values that are output by any two processes are comparable. And again, this proof follows from the earlier simple asynchronous lattice agreement proof, that if there are any two values that are ever output, then they must have a common acceptor, and that acceptor must have ordered them. Okay, liveness is a little bit more tricky, like I described. We want to show that every received value is eventually output, and we can show this in two steps. The first thing we are going to show is that every value that is ever received by a correct process is eventually proposed by some process, right? So we can show that, and this requires the assumption that we have reliable communication between correct processes. And that some proposer is eventually going to succeed in getting its proposal accepted. And that guarantees that eventually some process will propose a value. And the second lemma we are going to use is that every proposed value is eventually included in its output. So if you have these two steps, then you can guarantee that every value received by a correct process is eventually included in the output. So I'll not go through the proof in detail, the proof in more detail, but hopefully this gives you an intuition of why this works. Okay, so complexity. So as it turns out, generalized lattice agreement is also weight free. Not only can we guarantee that every received value is eventually included in an output, you can also guarantee that every received value is included in the output in a bounded number of steps. And that bound is basically the bound of the number of proposers. The second property of this algorithm is that it's also adaptive, in the sense that the complexity or the number of steps you have to take to get a received value accepted also depends on the number of concurrent proposers. Only depends on the number of concurrent proposers. So if you have a small number of proposers contending at any given point in time, not all n, then the value will get accepted quicker. So the complexity actually depends on how many processes are actively contending at any given point in time to get their values accepted, which is a nice feature to have. So you don't want to pay an order n cost, where n is the number of proposers, when most of the time you don't have everyone proposing values. Okay, so at this point time, a good question to ask is, where is all of this useful? Right. Where do you use generalized lattice agreement? So eventually, I'm going to show you that lattice agreement can, in fact, be used to do state machine replication. And this is something, state machine replication is something we've seen in the past, but only for a specific class of state machines. And before I describe that, we have to take a quick detour to some work by Mark Shapiro that describes a set of data types that are called commutative and convergent replicated data types that have some special properties which make them very natural for being used in this, used with lattice agreement to do state machine replication. Okay, so what are these commutative and convergent data types? So before I describe this, let's take another step back and look at this consistency property called eventual consistency. And this is something that has come up a few times in previous lectures. So what is eventual consistency? Right? Eventual consistency says that the state of all processes eventually converge. So if you have a set of processes that are receiving operations and they can communicate between them, then the state of all processes eventually converges to one value, right? And this eventual guarantee is based on it's eventual in the sense that it's only this guarantee holds is the system only has to guarantee that eventually the processes converge when all the updates quiesce, so when the system is not receiving any more updates, and all the processes get a chance to communicate with each other. Right? So that's eventual consistency. Now, where is this typically used? Right? One of the places where this is used is in quorum-based replicated systems, where often when you do updates, you don't do updates to a majority write quorum, right? Or essentially, when you do updates, the quorum of reads and quorum of writes don't cover all the processes. So in this case, what can happen is that the system can permit conflicting updates that other processes in the system don't know about, right? So you can have two updates that conflict. And guaranteeing eventual consistency requires that you often resolve these conflicts somehow. Right? So if you have two conflicting updates, like for example, you might have a shopping cart that has some items in it, and another shopping cart which has a conflicting set of items in it, then eventually when you do reads in the system, you have to resolve these conflicts. Right? And that's how you guarantee eventual consistency. So these commutative replicated data types are a special class of data types that have this conflict resolution built in. Right? They are data types that have been designed in such a way that the conflict resolution is all built in. Right? But they also guarantee an interesting property that the state that you reach eventually is consistent with the sequential semantics of that data type. Right? And this is not in general true. So in general, when you resolve conflicts, you can resolve conflicts in arbitrary ways. Right? For example, if you get two shopping carts that are incomparable, you can take a union, right? Which is not necessarily sequentially consistent with the semantics of a shopping cart. But these data types guarantee, not only guarantee that they have conflict resolution inbuilt, but they also guarantee that the final state you converge on eventually is consistent with the sequential semantics. And we'll see some examples of these data types. Right? So let's say that you wanted to implement a set data type, right? So a typical set has an API that lets you add an element, remove an element, and check for containment. Right? Now, in a typical set, when you do an add, the add operation returns a value that tells you whether the element was actually added or not. And when you do a remove, it again tells you whether the value was removed or not. But in this case, what we are going to do is that we are going to return voids. So we are not going to return whether the element was actually added or removed. Right? This is a change we are going to make to the set specification. Right? But the contains will, of course, still return Boolean. It will tell you whether the set contains this value or not. Yeah, it will actually add. But it just won't tell you whether the element was already existing or not. Right? Okay, so let's say you want to design this sort of a set. So how do you do this? So actually, just to simplify things, let's first consider a set that doesn't have contains, doesn't even have removes. All it does is it has adds, right? And that's much more simpler. And the adds doesn't have to return a Boolean, right? So what do you do? So this is just pseudocode. It's not designed to reflect an actual implementation. But hopefully, this gives you the intuition. So let's say we design the add in such a way that when you receive an element, you of course take a union of this element with your own state of the set, and then you send this add operation to all the other replicas. Right? That's all you do. And this send is, in this case, again, we are assuming reliable communication between correct processes. So just this very simple implementation without doing any agreement or any complex business is going to guarantee very trivially that all replicas eventually converge. Right? As long as all the messages get sent across to everyone, because the ad essentially commutes with all the other ads, this very simple implementation guarantees that all correct replicas will eventually converge. Right? That's very easy to see. So let's say you start with an initial set, you do two ads, potentially at two different places, and when you perform these ads, you send this operation to all the other correct processes, all the other processes, right? And eventually, because the ads commute, the replicas are guaranteed to converge to the same state, right? So this is how you can basically implement a set that just has ads. Okay, now, unfortunately, removes don't commute with ads, right? So let's say you have one replica that starts with one, with two replicas that start in the same state. One processes an ad, the other processes a remove. Now, simply, if you simply extended the previous algorithm and just sent these operations along to other replicas, even if they are eventually delivered to all the correct processes, depending on the order in which they apply the operations, they might end up in different states, which is not what eventual consistency. This is definitely not eventually consistent, because they don't necessarily have to converge to the same state. The final state depends on the order in which you perform these operations, right? So what we are going to do is we are going to play this subtle trick and try and make the internal implementation of the removes commute with the ads, right? So here's how you can do this. So what we are going to do is, sorry? Yeah, so exactly, that's what we are going to do. What we are going to do is something called the observed remove set. It's a very, very simple trick. What you do is when you receive an ad, you don't add the element directly to the set. Instead, you give it a new version number and then add to the set a tuple that contains the element and the version number. And you send the operation add e, v, which includes a version number, to all the other replicas. And when you do a remove, you first observe all the version numbers that you have, that you observe, you've seen from the other replicas. And this might include all the ads that you performed and ads that you have seen from other replicas. But you just observe this set. So in this case, the set V is all versions such that E, V belongs to your local copy of the set. Right? And you remove them from the, you remove these elements from the set. And then when you send a remove, you tag along with the remove this set of version numbers. And when the other replicas receive these version numbers, they only remove these versions. Right? In fact, you have to do a little bit more. The other replicas may not have seen some of these ads. So when they receive a remove, they have to remember this set. Right? And subsequently, if they get an ad, then they can remove that ad. But hopefully, this gives you an idea of why this implementation will eventually converge. So the idea here is, let's start with version 1, a in both replicas. We perform an add here and a remove here. This add is going to take this replica to a state where it has 1, a and 1, v, which are two different versions of one. And the remove here on the second replica observes only 1, a, right? And when it sends this remove across, it sends that version a along with it. And when that version is applied at both places, eventually, you get to the same state on both replicas, right? So in some sense, what this is doing is that it's sort of building conflict resolution into the data type, right? And what this guarantees, essentially, is that if you have concurrent adds and removes, then all adds that happen concurrently with some removes get ordered after the remove, right? So it's not producing some arbitrary state of the set. It produces a state in the end which appears as if all the removes, concurrent removes, happened before all the concurrent ads, right? So it prioritizes ads over removes. And what it also guarantees is that the eventual state is consistent with the sequential semantics of the set. That in this case, the final state appears as if the remove happened first and then the add happened, right? So there is a sequential ordering of all the operations, and the final state is consistent with some sequential ordering of all the operations you submit. Right, and in fact, this is just a set data type, but you can extend the same intuition to build other kinds, other data types. And that includes things like graphs, certain types of key value tables, and document trees, and so on. Right? And I'll refer you to a paper that describes some of these data types. But the key point here is that you can design some data types in such a way that they are eventually consistent, and the final state that they are in is also consistent with the sequential semantics of that data type. Okay, so now hopefully some of you are can see where this fits in with lattice agreement. So one of the questions you might want to ask with some of these data types is, well, how do you query these data types, right? The only thing they are guaranteeing is that eventually they reach a consistent state. But when you do queries on these data types, how do you do queries, right? So even if the updates commute, if you naively do queries on these data types, you're not guaranteed to get consistent results, right? So let's say you have this data type, which is on which you do two add operations, right? And what you can do is at intermittent points in time on each of these replicas, you can do queries. And let's assume a very naive implementation of queries that doesn't require a quorum. It just goes to the replica and reads its state, right? So what can happen is that you can read a state here, which is just before the add has been performed, and that's empty. At this point in time, you can read a state where this replica contains 1. And here you can see a state where the replica contains 2 and eventually contains 1 and 2. Now, of course, you should any set of reads should never see this sequence, right? Because you should either see empty set 1 and 1, 2, and empty set 2 and 1, 2. You shouldn't ever see a state where the set contains 1 and the set contains 2, because that's not serializable with respect to, that doesn't satisfy the sequential semantics of the data type, right? Okay, so this is in fact where if you want to make reads consistent, then you have to do a little bit more, right? And what we are going to do is, for these data types, we are going to use lattice agreement to do state machine replication, right? So here's how, in general, in fact, it doesn't just apply to the set data type, but to any arbitrary data type that satisfies some constraints. So we are going to use lattice agreement to implement a specific class of state machines where all the updates commute, where you have two types of operations. You have updates and queries and arbitrary reads. So you can read the whole set or whatever data type that is. And all the updates are commutative in the sense that the order in which you apply them doesn't matter to the eventual state. Right? So how are we going to do this? So the idea is that we will, all the updates will form the power set lattice. Right? So if you remember, in GLA, we have this potentially infinite lattice. And the updates here are going to form a power set lattice. And the join here is simply the union. The join of any two sets is simply the union. And replicas are going to propose operations from this lattice as and when they receive them. And we are going to serve queries using states that correspond to the output values of lattice agreement. And if you remember, the output values of lattice agreement are guaranteed to form a chain. So if you service queries using the output values of lattice agreement, then with some additional details that I'm skipping here, but what you will guarantee is that you will never see two queries that are inconsistent with each other. So any two queries are going to reflect a consistent set of operations of the underlying data type. Right? Okay. So here's again very simple pseudocode of how you can do state machine replication using lattice agreement. So when you receive an update from a client, so let's say that update is this operation op, right? What you're going to do is you're going to invoke, so this is what a replica does on a single replica does. When it receives an operation, it's going to call the underlying receive operation on GLA, right? It's going to tell GLA that this is an operation I've received, and GLA will do what it does underneath. It'll send this, it'll buffer this operation and send it to all the other replicas. And what you do is you wait until the value you have, the value you are outputting, that this replica outputs, includes this operation. Right? So if the value that the process outputs and a process is going to output this increasing sequence, if the value it outputs includes this operation, then you know that the operation has been committed in the system. And at that point in time, what you do is you return essentially this value, right, which is some representation of that set. And you return this to the client. And the client can use this value to use this value and send it to you in subsequent operations so that you can get program order, basically. So for example, if a client wants to do a read that follows this update, it can send this version number to you. And then what the read can do is it can just wait till it till the value at the replica, the output value at that replica is greater than the version number you sent. At that point in time, it can just take this value and construct a state from it. So at the point at this point in time, just assume that there's a function apply that lets you take a value, which is just a set of operations, and construct state from it. Right? And you can just do this apply and return the state to the client. Right? And this essentially guarantees sequential consistency, right? The versioning here ensures that you satisfy request in program order, and the underlying property of lattice agreement guarantees that any two queries are consistent. Any two queries sent to any two replicas are consistent in the sense that either one is comparable, either one is less than the other, or the other one is less than the first one. Right? Any two values are comparable. So all output values essentially form a chain. This is what we know from GLA. And there is a variant of this which you can also use to guarantee linearizability, which is if you want the operations to appear as if they occur instantaneously at one point in time, and the linearization point is inside the operation, there is a variant of this which also requires reads to be essentially proposed as operations. But all of this is still wait-free. So you can get different implementations of these commutative data types that support queries as well. Okay, so at this point in time, I'll very quickly describe this connection between lattice agreement and another problem that, in fact, has been studied in the past called generalized packsoft, right? And this is a problem that I don't think was discussed during the summer school, but essentially it's, again, a generalization of packsoft for agreeing on where replicas don't agree on a sequence of operations, but they agree on a partial order. And in fact, generalized packsoft is also meant to be used in a setting where some of the operations commute, right? And in fact, if all operations commute, then generalized packsoft also reduces to reliable broadcast. In fact, there is a strong similarity between these eventually consistent data types and generalized packsoft if all the updates were designed to commute, right? And there are some key differences, though. Generalized packsoft is, in fact, more general than lattice agreement in the sense that it allows non-commuting updates as well. In lattice agreement, we require all updates to commute. Generalized packsoft, in fact, is more general. It allows non-commuting updates as well. However, generalized packsoft in this more general setting is not wait-free if there are some non-commuting operations. Asynchronous. Yes. 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 Okay. So what GLA guarantees is that, so what is a wait condition, right? So what we are waiting for here is to output a value that is greater than this, right? GLA guarantees that this will eventually happen, and it will happen in a bounded number of steps, right? That's why it's wait free. This condition is eventually bound to be satisfied at all replicas. Sure.
And if we apply the quorum on the read, we'll get ABC because we are waiting for quorum and
So quorum, depending on how you apply it, doesn't guarantee that you'll see all the operations. Eventually, if you do queries, you will see all the operations. Right? Even here. Eventually, if you do queries, you will see all the updates. Because eventually all the values are going to be learned by an output. Right? So this also guarantees that. Eventually, if you wait, if the client issues a read, and the updates quiesce, then eventually you will see all the updates. But it doesn't restrict you to do queries in that sense. You can do queries at any point in time, and the response you receive is going to be a consistent state. Even though in the underlying implementation, these operations are still flowing around and they don't necessarily commit, they are not necessarily applied at the replicas in the right order. Yes, at least, yes, that's right, that's right. That's right, that's right. That's right. All the updates. You, because the updates might in fact still be processed, right? So when you do a query, there are still potentially concurrent updates in the system that are being sent to other replicas, right? So you when you propose a value, you don't even know about these other values. So when you propose, you propose values that you've seen, and if a quorum accepts that value, then you're done. Right? If you use GLA and get those values, get a proposal accepted, then you're done, and that value represents a consistent state. But it doesn't necessarily have to account for all the values. Eventually, it will, when the system quiesces, but not at all points in time. Oh, sorry. Yeah, this is greater than equal to. That's right. Yeah, you can wait as long as. The only thing you need is that this version has to be at least as large as this one. Yeah. Version numbers. Think of version numbers just as characterizing an output value. So it's some representation of this set. So they are in fact going to be unique for every set of operations. So think of a version number as characterizing a set of operations. So you can use vector clocks or timestamps or something to represent version numbers.
If two nodes have same value,
then they have the same. Yes. If two set values are the same, then they have the same version. That's all you need. Okay. So depending on how much time we have. Okay. So just about enough time. So as it turns out, Lattice agreement also has some other interesting applications, and I'll quickly describe the use of Lattice agreement in doing view maintenance, right? And some of this is still ongoing work, so the not all thoughts are completely fleshed out, but this is just to give you a feel for how the same approach basically applies in other places. Okay, so what is the view maintenance? What do we mean by view maintenance, right? So view essentially is, so if you have a set of relations in like a conventional database, you can think of a view as basically a query over a set of relations, right? So in this case, for example, if you have the set of users and a set of bids that, like in an auction application, you might in fact want to compute a join of these two relations and keep that as a view in the database, right? So that's what in databases are called materialized views. So a materialized view is basically a query that the database maintains. So you don't have to compute it every time. The database is going to maintain it, right? And the idea here is that if the database maintains it, then a client doesn't have to do all the work every time you ask for it. The database will do that work proactively, right? And the incremental view maintenance problem in databases is that when a base relation changes, you have to update the view, the physical view, to make sure that it reflects the state of the base relations, right? And the idea here is that if the changes are very small, or the number of changes is very large, there are lots and lots of changes happening, then you can compute these incremental changes to the view much more efficiently than, in fact, recomputing the whole view every time you get it, right? Because that's one naive approach of view maintenance, that every time something changes, you just recompute the whole query, right? But in incremental view maintenance, you sort of incrementally update the view. And the idea here is that it can be more efficient than recomputing the whole view. Okay, so what's distributed views? So a distributed view essentially lets you, conceptually you can have base relations and views. In a distributed setting, a distributed view essentially lets you have base relations and views at disjoint locations and on different nodes. Right? They don't have to be on a centralized database. You can in fact have a view that is on a different node than a base relation. More generally, in fact, you can have each of these relations partitioned across many nodes, and the view itself being partitioned across many nodes. And each of the partitions may or may not be replicated. Right? So in a truly distributed system, you want to replicate each of these relations for fault tolerance, but you might want to partition them to improve scale, to get more scalability. And you might want to keep the views separate from the base relations. You might want to vertically partition your state in such a way that the base relation stays on some nodes and the views stay on different nodes. Right? And the view maintenance problem here is that even when these base relations get updated, you want to make sure that the views remain consistent in this distributed setting. Okay, so what does it mean for views to be consistent? Right? And again, there are different notions of consistency. Just like you saw various notions of consistency in replicated systems, even in view maintenance, there are different notions of consistency. So the strongest notion of consistency is something called complete consistency. And the terminology here is a little different from what people use in replicated state machines. So it can get a little confusing, but hopefully we'll try and get through this. So what complete consistency says is that there must, if you look at the state of let this states S0, S1, S2 represent the state of all base relations put together. Right? And the states V0, V1, V2, V3 represent the states of the views, of a single view. Right? Complete consistency requires that there must exist a mapping, in fact, a bijective mapping between the state of the view and the state of the base relations. So for every state of the view, there must be a corresponding state in the base relations. And in fact, what you also require is that if the states of the view are increasing in that order, there must be a corresponding increasing state of the base relations. Right? So your view must exactly follow every single update that you have that is made on any of the base relations. Right? So every time a base relation changes, you want it to atomically reflect on all the views. Right? That's what complete consistency requires. And the way this is typically implemented is that all the view updates are logically performed in the same transaction as the update on the base relation. Right? So if you can see that if you do this, if you update all the views in the same transaction as the base relation, then you can guarantee complete consistency. Right? However, this fundamentally doesn't scale as well if you have a large number of views in a distributed system, because you have to use transactions, and that sort of increases the latency of updates. So every time you do an update on the base relation, you now also atomically have to update all the views. Right? And that can be very, very expensive. So a weaker notion of consistency, which interestingly in the view maintenance world is called strong consistency. It's weaker because it's weaker than complete consistency. This only requires an injective mapping between states of views and states of base relations. Right? So essentially what it requires is that if the view does not have to mimic, reflect the state of base relations every time the base relation changes. A view can skip some states. As long as there is a one-to-one mapping, as long as every view state is mapped consistently to some base state, it can skip some states. Right? So this is a strong, but it is weaker than complete, which requires the view to keep up to date with changes on the base relations. What it also requires is that every view should have this property, that they should all have a map. There should be a mapping from the states of every view to the states of the base relation. And the mapping should reflect the same sequence of updates on the base relation. Right? So even though this view does not reflect this state here, and it reflects this state, that view reflects this state, but they are all consistent with the same sequence of operations on the base relations. So this basically allows views to be a little bit stale, but it guarantees that the views are always consistent with some operations on the base relation. Right? So this is what is known as strong consistency. And essentially the idea here is that this permits asynchronous maintenance of views. So you don't have to atomically update all the views every time you change a base relation. you can do it asynchronously. You can commit a transaction on the base relations and then update the views at some point in time later, as long as you guarantee that this property holds. Right? Unfortunately, as it turns out, many large-scale distributed systems today, at least in the past, haven't supported views at all, or at least haven't supported consistent views. So if you recollect, Sudarshan described a few systems, and one of those systems was a system called Peanuts, which in fact lets you do asynchronous view maintenance, but it doesn't satisfy these consistency properties. Right? What we are going to do is, again, ask the question of how do you do distributed view maintenance in a way that guarantees consistency, but still is weight free in the sense of weight freedom we described earlier. Right? Okay, so how do you do view maintenance using lattice agreement? So I'm going to give a very simple example and then finish. So let's take a very simple example of so essentially the idea here is that in lattice agreement we were exploiting the property that the updates commute, right? And it turns out that in view maintenance, often when you have all the updates that you do to maintain a view often have this property that you can design them in a way that they in fact commute, that the order in which you do the view maintenance doesn't matter as long as you agree on the right set of operations, right? So this holds for certain kinds of views like equi-joins, aggregations like count, min, and max, where the actual order in which you do operation doesn't matter. For example, if you're computing maximum, the order in which you do the max doesn't matter as long as you eventually agree on the right set of operations. Right? So we are going to use this commutativity property of view maintenance operations. So we'll use lattice agreement. We can use lattice agreement to learn these consistent sets of view maintenance operations. Essentially, all these view maintenance operations, again, form a power set lattice. The base relations are now going to act as proposers of these values. And the views are going to learn these values. Instead of the proposer learning the value back, the views are the ones who are going to learn these values and apply the values in a way that's consistent. Right? So let's look at a very simple example. So let's say you have you want to do an aggregation over a single partition relation. So you have a single relation that has been partitioned across a large number of machines. So you have k partitions. They may or may not be replicated. Right? That's a choice that the implementation has to, that the user has to make. The only thing we are going to assume is that operations on each partition are serialized. So they appear in serial order. And what you want to do is some kind of an aggregation. Right? So we are going to use an architecture like this. So you have a set of base relations. They are going to propose values to a set of acceptors. And the views, in this case an aggregation, which itself might be partitioned, the view is going to learn the output values of the acceptors and going to apply the operations in such a way that gives you strong consistency. Right? So here's a simple example. So let's say you have a base relation that has three attributes, city, sales, and month. So it tells you that in a given month, in a specific city, how much sales were made. Right? And what you want to do is you want to do an aggregation on this relation that groups the sales by month, right? And for each month, computes the sum of the sales. So for every month, you know how much sales have been made, right? So you want to do this, and you want to materialize this query, right? So how do you do this? So let's say you have this base relation, which has now been partitioned, say, by city. So this two instances of this base relation reside on different machines, and they are partitioned by city, right? So, and we are going to have a set of acceptors, and maybe you want to partition this relation as well by some attribute. So let's say we want to partition this one by month, right? So you want each of these to reflect each of these partitions to store the sales for 1 month. Now let's say you receive an operation add which to some city A and some value X for the month of Jan. Right? That's what you're adding to this relation. Now, what view maintenance will do in this case is that it will, of course, send this operation to the views, just like we sent operation to all the other relations, right? Wherever the relation, the operation has to be applied, we send this operation to the view. But we also propose to all the acceptors a value in this case which think of it as a representation of the set of operations. Right? We are going to use like a vector timestamp to represent this. So in this case, the value is 1, 0, which represents the fact that you've received one operation on this relation, and you don't know of any operations on the other relation. So you're going to propose that value. Right? Now, at the same time, you might concurrently receive an operation from on the other base relation. Right? So you'll receive an operation add B, Y, and in the same month, Jan. Right? So this is on a different partition. And this will also, of course, send the value eventually. But note that the view cannot, when it receives an operation, it cannot apply these operations in random order. Right? Well, it can apply it, and eventually it will get to the same state. But if you are doing queries on the view, then you might not get the outputs. You might not get states in a consistent order. Right? So these views don't apply these operations when they receive them. But the base relation is now going to propose this other value, right? That it knows no operations from this relation, but one operation from the other on itself. It's going to propose this. Right? Now, like we do in lattice agreement, these acceptors are going to help the views find out a set of values, a sequence of values that forms a chain. Right? So each view is going to learn that a sequence of values that forms a chain. So what might happen is, for example, this view might learn a value 0, 1 followed by 1, 1, which forms a chain in this lattice. Right? In which case, it can first apply the second operation from that other replica, from the other partition, and compute the sum as y, and then compute the sum as xy. Right? And alternatively, it can also learn 1, 0, and 1, 1, which still forms a chain in the lattice. In which case, the view will first reflect x and then reflect x plus y. Right? Or it might, in fact, just learn 1, 1, in which case it will reflect just x plus y. But it will never, this view itself will never reflect x and then y separately. Right? Or, in fact, if there are operations happening concurrently that are going to this other view is also going to learn values from the same chain. Right? And it's going to apply those values. So if you think about it a little bit more, you can see why this guarantees that strong consistency. Right? You can have two different partitions or different views on this base relation, but they are all learning a chain in this lattice. And operations that they are doing are all commutative anyway. So if they can answer queries using this chain in the lattice, you can guarantee that the views are strongly consistent. They are not completely consistent, but they are strongly consistent. And if there are questions about this, I can talk about this more offline. Okay, so the characteristics of this sort of view maintenance is that views are essentially updated every time you learn new output values from the acceptors. And you can also control how frequently the views get updated by just controlling how frequently you make proposals. Right? The system is fault tolerant in the sense that we've seen before. All you require is reliable communication between base relations, acceptors, and views. The partitions, in fact, can fail. Some partitions of the system can fail, of the base relations can fail. In fact, the views can also fail. But any correct view is guaranteed to make progress as long as there is a single base partition, which is receiving operations, of course, and a majority of acceptors are alive. Right? So the system is fault tolerant. And strongly consistent, like I described earlier. Okay, so I think it's about time to finish. Just to summarize, what we looked at is this problem called lattice agreement and a generalization of that problem. We saw that basically this problem turns out to be one of those problems that, in fact, is solvable in a general asynchronous system. The primitive can be used to build some interesting replicated data types that guarantee strong consistency, and can be used to do some kind of view maintenance, right? And there are this is still ongoing work. There are lots of open problems here. It's of course not as mature as other consensus protocols, and there are things like reconfiguration that are still fairly hard in this world. But that's how it is. There are lots of open problems, but at least in theory, it's an interesting protocol It's different from consensus because it doesn't, it makes lesser assumptions about the system you're running on. Okay, and if there are more questions, I'll be happy to take them. Yeah, otherwise it's time for a break, I guess. Thank you.